I'm Andy Hopkins, and I currently work as Director of Microcontamination Control at AbbVie, which is a real passion of mine. I've been working for AbbVie for 4 years now, but prior to that, I worked for the MHRA, where I made the grade of Expert Inspector, which is their most senior grade. And probably the most famous thing I'm remembered for is that I started the Annex 1 rewrite there. So that's probably me in a nutshell, 40 years experience in industry.
So I'm Tracy Moore. First of all, thank you for inviting me here. It's my pleasure to be here also. And I work for a company called TM Pharma Group, which is my own consultancy firm. And I recently left MHRA in December 2021, after being there for 10 years.
So, I mean, the minimum expectation is that you're fully ready for it. Now, whether that's going to be realistic given the 1 year time frame may be up for discussion, but what I've said frequently is that the Annex actually doesn't have a lot of changes in terms of requirements, so it shouldn't be too big a deal for people. However, there are some changes that I think people are aware of, the contamination control strategy. There will be times when you can't actually comply with the annexes, so a lot of the new technologies that the Annex is driving people towards, that may be acceptable initially, but what you really have to do is make sure you've got a clear strategy for moving to a compliant state, and also something that says why we're okay at the moment, what is our interim control measures that mean that when we get to that compliant state in 1 or 2 years' time, by spending a lot of money on the RABs or the isolators, we know until that point we're making safe product.
The expectations on firms have always been there. It's just been better clarified in Annex 1. I know that there are a number of different territories that are seeing this as quite a stepwise increase. But certainly from a UK perspective, these were kind of standard expectations. And it's just better clarifying now the requirements. Probably the biggest preparation they can do is a gap analysis. And it's a really good time to have a look at those old risk assessments that were written, make sure that they are current, review the processes. Because when you're writing the contamination control strategy, you should be able to signpost those existing documents. So it's a really good time to shake the dust off and make sure that they are still current.
So a big thing, which I'm not sure everybody always picks up on, but I've spoken a lot about quality risk management, which is a key change to all of the GMP documents. And a key part of that is knowledge management. So we're in an industry where you've got a lot of old people like me who are starting to retire and take away knowledge with them. We need to work out how we sustain that knowledge, especially when you look at the way that perhaps new graduates are trained. It's a little bit more virtual, a little bit more book learning, because the old learning on the bench as a microbiologist, for instance, has changed. So we need to think about how we impart that knowledge to those people and carry on with that sustained knowledge. So it really emphasises the need for design as your key element of QRM, and one of the key parts of that design is keeping the operator away from your product. I mean, the operator is the dirtiest thing in your clean room, if you like. So it's really important that we use those barriers to move away from having operators making open interventions. The Annex is very clear, RABs and isolators is the way to go. Or as new technologies come along, they may replace RABs and isolators, but certainly the old technologies are not really meeting current expectation anymore.
So what Annex 1 has been really clear about is the use of barrier systems, either RABs or isolator. And the intent of that is to increase the protection of the product, which will benefit the patient. There is a clause in there that says about anything else can be justified. However, I think this is going to be extremely difficult because there's what is their explanation for not providing that protection to the patient? From a stopper transfer perspective, the technology has increased significantly over the years. Gone are the days where you need to be cutting bags and shaking them above stopper hoppers. There are things like rapid transfer ports, there are sterilisation vessels that can sterilise the stoppers in situ, and then a big robotic arm comes and loads it directly into a chute. So a hands-free approach to stopper transfer into an isolator is a huge improvement, and the technology is there.
PUPSIT has always been a requirement, and it's been in the annex, and we've looked back to the late 90s and it was the annex even then. What is much clearer on now is it actually uses the phrase PUPSIT and says you must do it. So people are a little bit confused because it talks about things like saying, well, there are some very specific exemptions when you don't need to do PUPSIT, but they are very specific. So people can't just say, well, PUPSIT is quite difficult to do, so we've done a risk assessment, we're not going to do it. That's not what the annex is saying. It's saying if you've got a small volume, high value, criticality, biological product, for instance, that you don't want to waste half of it on a PUPSIT, that might be a discussion you can have. To do that, though, there is then a list of items that you need to assess. Things like how are the filters handled, how are they sterilised, how are they transferred, how are they stored, and they're really important. And people say to me, well, we all store our filters properly. I've been to warehouses where you see a footprint on top of the filters because somebody stood on it to get to something higher. So that's really the controls it's looking for in the exemption of PUPSIT, if you can use that exclusion. Stopper transfer, it's probably a wider thing than that. You'll see that there's a whole new section really around pass-throughs and airlocks. That's really trying to get people to think about the barriers you have around your core and how you remove the risk of transferring contamination through that process. So stoppers or whatever it is, people are really looking, or the regulators are looking for us to move to things like rapid transfer ports, beta ports, that sort of thing, that remove the operator away from that intervention. So that's where we're going with that sort of thing.
The most frequent question is probably about an isolator being in a grade C environment and why can't it be in a grade D? Mm-hmm. So the requirement for it to be in a C was always an expectation. I think the original phrasing was a minimum of a D. So the expectation was a C, but the word generally is in there. So if there is by any chance some other kind of mitigation that can be provided, an inspector can look at it, but the expectation is actually C as a default.
I think the other biggest subject is the contamination control strategy and what that looks like. So again, a couple of points there. It's not new. It's been in the GMP since 2015 when Chapter 5 was updated. But I think people are overcomplicating it as well. The intent of the contamination control strategy is that it's a roadmap, probably to most of the documents that already exist. If it's the design of my facility, I've got it in my DQ and my qualification package. That's all I need to do is point to it. If it's the environmental monitoring, I should have my risk assessments already in place and my procedures in place. So it's a roadmap that brings it all together as a strategy rather than individual elements. I don't think there are. I think a lot of people are actually fighting to do it. You will see a lot of the industry bodies are starting to give guidance on it. So PDA recently produced TR90, which is a guidance on CCS. I think people are still struggling to put them together though at the moment. But what I would say on that is don't overcomplicate it. Myself and another regulator probably instigated the CCS section. We didn't put all the detail to it, Tracy did that, but we didn't put all the detail to it. But what I would say is we never intended it to be like an encyclopedia of RPN numbers. It's meant to be a common sense approach where you can go, okay, this is my process, here's the risks, how, and this is how we control them.
I think whilst it's a short-term pain that companies are going through, it will provide that roadmap. Now, as a former inspector, one of the things that used to really surprise me is that when I asked companies for their strategy of how they minimise contamination, that they couldn't actually have a full answer. And the idea is that this roadmap will signpoint to those existing procedures, validation reports, risk assessments that provide the evidence that the company has looked into their processes, understood the contamination risk, and have the appropriate measures and monitoring in place. You would be very hard-pressed to try and justify a process now that didn't have an isolator or a closed RAPS. The importance from an Annex 1 perspective is purely looking at contamination, how to minimise it, and ensuring that that product at the end is safe for a patient. So from a capital expenditure perspective, there has to be significant work to justify, or rather to ensure that the company is buying the right equipment for the right task, and the justification on cost is not acceptable.
Well, they need to make sure they're up with the barrier technologies. I mean, that's key. Again, it's not a new requirement. The directives from 2001 and 2003 have all talked about the MAHs, or the marketing authorisation holders, responsibility to keep up with new technologies. The annex is now just really emphasising that. And it has that nice section that says you should use RABs and isolators. And if you don't, you need to justify it. I'm not quite sure how you justify doing anything else. So it's really making sure that your future capital expenditure, probably the biggest part of this, keeps up with these requirements.
One of the good things that Annex 1 did do is bring in an existing requirement, which is that companies must keep up with technological advances. So the rapid micro methods was added into Annex 1 to try and give the green light to companies to say, you know, don't be afraid of this, do keep up with technology, do make those leaps and bounds into the unknown, and have the data available. You know, the fear is not, will the regulators accept it? You know, the fear should be, am I doing enough to keep up with technology?
With the way the regulators have moved now, there is very much a tripartite discussion going on, and it's between the pharmaceutical industry, the regulators, the suppliers like SKAN have a key part in that discussion, and making sure that they understand industry and regulators' needs, but also making sure that the customer understands what they're buying, because they don't always. So yeah, that would be a key part for SKAN for me.